Well, a huge welcome to King's Church West Lothian. So glad you can join us for this service. And we're just going to draw close to God together. It's so important that we do that each week, that in these strange times that we find ourselves, that we just take a moment to refresh ourselves, focus on Jesus, keep the main thing the main thing. And so we're going to do that together. In a moment, we're going to worship. We're then going to hear Mike preach to us about the grace of God. And then at the end of the service, I'm just going to share a few practicalities about us meeting live again, which we're doing in a few weeks, and what that's going to look like, how it's going to work, how we're making a few changes to keep everybody safe. Let me just encourage you before we worship. 1 Corinthians 5 says, Christ died so that whether we're awake or asleep, we can live together with him. So encourage one another, build one another up, just as you're doing. Let me pray for us. Lord, we want to draw close to you this afternoon or this morning, whatever time it is watching this. We want to say we're sorry for any sin in our lives, anything that is blocking us from you, anything that our conscience is troubled by. Would you forgive us? Would you cleanse us by the blood of Jesus? We want to come close to you this afternoon. We want to draw into your presence. And that invitation that you say, come, all who are weary, and I'll give you rest. We want to come to you, Jesus, this afternoon. So we're looking to you. Help us to worship. Help us to hear your words. And would you please refresh us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, guys, let's worship together.
Explain the cross to us, Mark.
I just love the message. I'm Scottish, right? And I think that the cross is like this, is that, you know, you've got, imagine a beautiful Scottish castle and it's cold and wet outside and you'd love to get in there and you can see the lights on in the castle and you can smell the food, but there's a huge big trench around the castle and you can't get to it. And however much you would like to get in, you can't go under it, you can't get in there. You know there's a welcome in that castle for you, but you're out in the cold. You are out in the cold. But then what happens? The drawbridge comes down and you're able to come over the drawbridge into the welcoming arms. And for me, that is the message of the cross. God is warmth. He's got a celebration for us. He's got the best life for us. He's got peace and destiny and hope. And we can't get in. We're messed up. We're out in the cold. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But what does God do? He sends Jesus on the cross. And the cross is the drawbridge that comes down.
Absolutely.
That Jesus came down from heaven. He would come low, low down, so that we could actually come through the cross, through the drawbridge, into the arms of God.
Absolutely.
How amazing that God's Son would make himself the floor, the ground, the dirt that we were able to walk over into the arms of God. He humbled himself to become the drawbridge, and that we can come through the drawbridge into the arms of God. How grateful are we to Jesus? How honoring that Jesus would do this, and we can be welcomed into God's arms and enjoy the feast. Wow.
That is such a beautiful picture. Beautiful, that drawbridge. As you said it, I could always see it coming down, coming down, so that we can go across it.
Hi everyone. We'd love to teach you a new song today. It's called The Final Say. It's all about Jesus being high above all things, and we're really enjoying it at the moment, so we thought we'd teach you the chorus before we run it all through. So it goes like this.
Your love broke through the darkness, Jesus, high above all things, you have the final say, you have the final say, your kingdom reigning forever, Jesus, your name is greater, you have the final say, you have the
about Jesus having the last word, the final say. So it's a declaration, so we're declaring it as we sing it. Jesus, you're going to have the final say. Doesn't matter how you're feeling, what you're going through, what life has thrown at us, Jesus is in control. He has the final say.
Amen. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Say, I thank you that history doesn't surprise you. Thank you that you have a plan and you're going to have the final say. So we worship you as the the history maker, as the saviour, as the one that is sovereign. We lift you up. Yes, we God. Just together say, Jesus, you're worthy, you're on the throne, and we just honour you, Jesus.
Let's just all lift our voices, God, and we just worship you today, God, the King on the throne, the perfect King, so full of truth and grace and justice, so perfect in love, so perfect in love and mercy. Oh, we thank you, Lord, we come to you, we look to you, Jesus, we look to you, Lord, yes, God, you are worthy of our praise, God. Verse here in Colossians 2 says, so then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. For in Christ all the fullness of God lives in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. Once you were dead in your sins, but God has made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, praise you God, having cancelled the written code with its regulations that was against us and stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. Having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Jesus, we just thank you, Lord, that you reign, Lord, that you came to earth, you lived, you died on a cross to free us from our sin. Jesus, we just thank you, Lord, that the fullness of God dwells in you, Lord, and that we have been given fullness in Christ. Oh, I praise you, God. I praise you for the freedom. And we just pray you'd help us to live rooted in you, Lord, strengthened in you, Jesus, just built up in you today, just remembering who we are in Christ. Oh, we give you glory, Lord. Thank you, God.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all. With truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. You've done for me, yeah, all that you've done, Lord. Oh, praise you, Lord, lift is the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
Yes, God, we just thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Hello, everybody. I want to start this talk today by asking you to use your imagination. I want to take you back to an experience that you've almost certainly had, but which may have been horrifically painful for you. I want to ask you to take yourself back to your school playground and to the experience of you and all your classmates being lined up and being picked to go into different teams. Nobody, of course, wanting to be the last pick. Imagine as every single other person apart from you is being picked and you are the final one. Now, hold that thought, but I want to change it. Imagine instead of there being two teams and two captains picking the teams, there's only one team. And there's only one captain, and that captain is God himself. And he is picking the team with which he is going to build his kingdom on earth. Naturally, you look from side to side to see who you're up against, who might be picked instead of you. On your right, you see the Pope. On your left, you see Billy Graham. Looking further down the line, you see some of the greatest apostles and martyrs of history. And you think to yourself, I don't stand a chance. Look at these people. Why would God choose me? And while you're fearing the worst, knowing that you're not going to make it on the team, God looks up and down the line. His eyes settle on you. Points his finger directly at you and says, I choose you. This, friends, is the grace of God. Today we are starting a new teaching series on the grace of God. Now, when I say that, to be honest, I must admit, internally, I cringe a little bit. And the reason for that is this. The grace of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ are one and the same thing. Grace is the gospel and the gospel is grace. So if we say we're doing a series on that, that might imply somehow that we ever aren't doing a series on that. And of course, as believers in Jesus, we preach from the Bible. And so grace and the gospel is absolutely always at the center of what we are always talking and teaching about. However, at times it is good to look with a little bit more depth at what grace really means, and as we look deeper in the Bible and see how that concept intertwines, how it develops and progresses, ultimately coming to Jesus Christ himself and his death and resurrection. The first time that we really get to grips with the concept of grace in the Bible goes right back to the Old Testament, and there is a fascinating meeting between Moses and God on the mountain of Sinai. And Moses asks God to show him his glory, and they have a bit of a back and forth about this, but eventually God agrees and he says that he can't see his face, but he will say his name, because he hasn't revealed his name yet in full, and Moses will be allowed to see his back. Okay, and so this is in Exodus 34 verses 6 and 7. That's what it says. And he passed in front of Moses, that is God, proclaiming, "The Lord, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin." Imagine if that was your name. This is how God wants himself to be known to Moses, to Israel, and going forward to all humanity, as compassionate and gracious, forgiving sin. Have you ever thought of yourself in those terms, as a wicked, rebellious sinner? You see, the Bible has both bad news and good news. The bad news is that you are almost certainly worse than you think you are, and that there is a genuine, real judgment and punishment for your rebellious, wicked sinfulness. The good news is this, that it is deeply embedded in God's character to want to forgive you for the things that you have done. Hallelujah. After the American Civil War, in which the north of the country fought against the south, Abraham Lincoln won the war with the north. And as you can imagine, at the end of the war, there was all sorts of things to be sorted out between this deeply divided country. But one of the things that needed to be sorted out was what was to be done with the people that had deserted the army of the north for whatever reason. They had fled. They didn't want to fight, and so they'd fled the battle lines. Now, of course, the punishment for desertion is death. It's capital punishment, execution. And so the people who had deserted could naturally expect, once they were caught, that they would be punished in this way. However, as you can imagine, they were pretty keen to avoid this fate. And so what anybody did who was in that situation is they would persuade any of their influential friends to write to the president and plead their case. And so, of course, many pardons were granted, as if you were maybe a senator or a sheriff or a mayor, you would write a letter, and naturally a pardon would be granted. However, some people, most people maybe, they didn't have any friends, at least not any influential ones. What were they going to do? Well, what they did was they threw themselves on the mercy of the president. They would write a letter to him, and the letter would be presented to the president, and it would be explained to him, yeah, this person, he's requesting pardon, but he doesn't have any friends to recommend him. To which Abraham Lincoln would always reply, well, in that case, I will be their friend. And he would recommend the soldier to himself and grant a pardon. It's a little bit like that with God. We don't have any good reason to expect from God that he will do anything other than punish us for our sins, other than the fact it is absolutely within the character of God himself. He says about us, he will be our friend, and he grants us that pardon such that we will not be punished as our sins deserve. Now, I don't want you, though, to misunderstand what God is like. He is not some cosmic slot machine in which we, you know, we put in our sin and out pops God's forgiveness. It doesn't work like that. God's grace is not as one-dimensional as that. You might have noticed when I read the passage from Exodus that the grace of God is coupled with another character, and that is compassionate. When we sin, God isn't just angry with us because we sin. No. His heart bursts with emotion and sorrow because of the things that we do. When he considers our plight as we fall deeper and deeper into the folly of our own sin. Let me just skip forward in the Bible to another passage which shows how God feels about those who strayed far from him. Isaiah 61. It says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, to release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion." See, God doesn't just see you as a wicked, rebellious sinner. He also sees you as poor, brokenhearted, a captive, a prisoner, as someone who's mourning and grieving. Can you see yourself in that description? Brokenhearted, a captive, a prisoner, grieving, mourning. You know, I've been walking with Jesus for quite a few years now, and one of the things that I've noticed is that when I come across people who would never describe themselves in this way, even in their innermost thoughts, simply because they have a lot of earthly blessings. They might have money, good family, good jobs, good education. They might be cultured individuals. They would never see themselves as brokenhearted or a captive or a prisoner. I've personally always found it really difficult to make people like that see that they really do need God, just because for what they see all around them, why do I need God? On the other hand, when I've spoken to people who are maybe a little bit further down the scale, who have spent time being brokenhearted, maybe come from broken homes, have experienced heartbreak in their own lives, maybe have been not just a spiritual prisoner but an actual real life prisoner, and experienced other hardships in this way, it's much easier to make people like that see that they really do need God. Maybe they've led more sinful lives perhaps, and it's easier to see they need forgiveness and they need to experience God's love. I've often wondered why that might be, why God would show his grace and mercy to those who know that they need it because of their circumstances. And I think the answer lies in the fact that God, he doesn't want to gather a crack team of culture makers who can really transform the world by their own efforts and powers and works to convince the world that God is really there and that we really should be getting alongside him. That's not how God works. There's a move even further into the Bible, into the New Testament. There's a fascinating passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, which is written by the Apostle Paul, and he writes to the Corinthian believers, and he tells them not to worry about the fact that they're not really important people in worldly terms. And this is what he says. He says, not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential or of noble birth, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong, the lowly things and the despised things, the things that are not, to nullify the things that are. You see, God's kingdom is about bringing glory to God. He chooses in his wisdom to take the things that are less and make them into something wonderful and thereby bring glory to himself. So then, to take us back to our original starting point, back into your school playground, you're the last person that any sane God would have chosen. And yet, God chose you. Not because of anything you have to offer, but simply for the fact that he wants to forgive you. And he wants to bind up your broken heart. And he wants to show mercy and love, so that you might bear fruit for him. Now, I know that my picture doesn't really work, because the fact is that God doesn't just choose one person over everybody else. The fact is that he is willing to choose you and you and you and you and you. And in fact, what that does is that it brings together a beautiful tapestry of broken-hearted, rebellious people who have been redeemed, made righteous and holy by the grace of God, and built us together into a wonderful body, into a wonderful house, beautiful picture of God's grace. To get, that is what the church looks like. That is what the kingdom looks like. So I just want to encourage you today. Don't try and bring your good works to God. God already has more than enough good works in himself. Instead, come to him with an attitude of thankfulness, of prayer, of worship, and thank him that his grace, his compassion extended to you.
Thanks, Mike. Guys, why don't we just take a moment to respond? And let's just thank God, you know, through the worship, through the words, there are things that you will have been reminded of that you can just thank God for right now. So let's just take a minute and just in your own words, in your own heart, let's just start thanking God for some of these things. You know, thank you, God, that I'm forgiven. Thank you, God, that you chose me. Just say some things in your own words. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you that you love me. Thank you that I'm a son of God. Thank you that no sin that I've committed is beyond your grace and your forgiveness. Thank you that you haven't treated me as my sins deserve. We worship you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Amen. Okay, guys, I promised you a few notices, a few practicalities. So I just want to spend a moment speaking to you about what's going to happen when we go back to the Lanthorn. As you may have known from previous weeks or from the newsletter, we're going to have a couple of monthly gatherings this side of Christmas where we're meeting together back at the Lanthorn in person. And I, for one, am really looking forward to seeing you, really looking forward to us encouraging one another, being able to just be in the same room together and draw close to God together. So just to explain what that's going to look like, we've created a document, which I will just fire onto your screen now. Okay, so here we go. So this is on our church website. It's also in the newsletter, which comes out every week. So do have a read. This is basically a few things that we're doing changes that we're making, putting in place to make sure that we keep everybody safe when we're back together. So yeah, let me just run through it for you, just so we're all clear of how it's going to look. So it's the 8th of November, we're gathering back. That's the first Sunday altogether. It's really important, you have to book in. Okay, you can't come unless you book. So it's really important you do that. We're limited to 50 people. That's the current government guidelines for places of worship. So we need to make sure we know who's coming, and you can only come if you book in. It's really easy. If you click on this link here or go to our website, you'll find the link on the website as well. It'll bring you to this page and you'll notice there's two Sundays, November the 8th, December the 6th. You click on them and then you just click sign up. It'll ask you for your name, contact number, and that's all you have to do. So it's dead easy, but just make sure you do it. It tells you how many places there are. So we've currently got 21 places left for the first Sunday. So do book in ASAP because they're going to fill up really quick. Okay, so that's how you book in. And just a couple of other things. So when we come to the 8th of November or the 6th of December, if you're not feeling well, please don't come. However tempted you are, if you have any symptoms of COVID-19 or just any illness at all, or if you're self-isolating, please don't come to the meeting. Face masks. We do need to wear face masks in the lanthorn, so please wear a face mask. If you're under 11 or if you have health conditions that mean you're exempt, you don't have to, but otherwise, please make sure you have your face mask. Hand washing. Around the building, you're going to find various hand sanitization points, so please make use of those as you're moving around the building. Social distancing, we have to keep 2 meters apart from other households, so please do that. I know it's going to be hard. I know we're used to hugging and greeting, but we just can't do that at this point. So just keep your distance from those that aren't in your own household, and the chairs are going to be laid out to reflect that. And to be honest, all those things I've mentioned, they're the things you're used to anyway now as you go to the supermarket and other places. So no massive surprises there. One that is unique to us is we're currently not allowed to sing as a congregation. It's just because loud voices and singing just release more droplets into the atmosphere. So we're going to have a worship band. There'll be people singing from the front, but we're just not allowed to join in. We can still worship God. You can still raise your hands. You can still dance if you want to. You could clap. You could mime under your face masks, but we're just not all allowed to sing all together. So it's going to take a bit of getting used to, but that's just the current guidance for places of worship. There's not going to be any refreshments for obvious reasons. Feel free to bring your own coffee, but we won't be serving tea and coffee like we normally do. And the last one is for kids. All of our kids' work is now going to be upstairs in the lanthorn. It just means there's a bit more space. We can use the lounge area, spread the kids out a bit. There'll be hand sanitization as you come into the kids' work. There's a bit of a one-way system we're going to be using, which will be signposted, but we'll keep you right and we'll help you out when you arrive. So guys, that just gives you a bit of a flavour. Just wanted to encourage you that we have things in place which will mean we can gather safely whilst looking after those that are vulnerable. But please do come. We would love to see you. And just love to reconnect with you. It's been so good actually looking at the sign up and seeing people signing in who haven't been able to connect with us on Zoom for different reasons. So it's just going to be great to be back together. So do book in. The places are going quick, but we'd love to see you on the 8th of November. Okay, let's stop sharing that screen. Final couple of notices. Next Sunday is Messy Church. So if you have kids, there's no normal kids work. But Messy Church is happening, and you can get that video from the Facebook page or the YouTube page from Sunday morning. Also next weekend, we've got Terry Virgo speaking to us on Sunday. He's recording a message for us as a church. So he leads New Frontiers, the family of church, or used to, he founded New Frontiers. So he's just a great preacher. It'll be great to hear from Terry next Sunday. And this Wednesday, if you're part of the church, the guys are gathering. It's a guys' night on Wednesday night, back on Zoom again. We'd love to see you there. Guys, final thoughts as we sign off. This is in 2 Thessalonians. It says, we pray, and this is my prayer for you and for us this week. We pray that the name of the Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. May the name of the Lord Jesus be glorified in you as we go through this week. Guys, God bless you. We'll see you soon. Have a great week.